Isaiah, in our first reading, tells us that God's ways are above our ways. His thoughts are above our thoughts. As high as the heavens, he says, are high, so high are God's thoughts above our thoughts. In other words, we cannot even really fathom God's thoughts. And then we hear that example of the parable of the landowner from Jesus, and it seems to offend our sense of fairness in this life, right? Jesus turns the parable upside down. The landowner, am I not free to do with my money as I want? Are you envious because I am generous? It seems that they are, right? It seems that we would probably be too. But what should the wealthy do with all their extravagant wealth? I thought about this today. I said, does Jeff Bezos really need $600 billion in this life? $600 billion, imagine that. You can't spend that. $10 million, I think, is enough for any person, right? I think that the rest should be shared. Did he really work for $600 billion? No, there's a lot of people that worked for him, of course, making much, much, much less than that. Now, am I a socialist because I think that he should be generous? No, I don't think so. I make a pittance compared to Jeff Bezos, of course, and compared to Bill Gates and many others in this life, compared to Oprah Winfrey even. But I think that when I give to charity, I bet that I'd be more generous percentage-wise, you know, of my salary. And that's probably true of most of us. But this gospel parable shows us that when any human measurement is applied to God's kingdom, it always comes up short. It always comes up short. Human beings and God work and think on a drastically different playing field. God, Jesus is telling us, is that landowner, that generous landowner who welcomes people to his vineyard until the very last moment of the day. For God, it's never too late. Never too late for people to come to him and to seek to do his will and thus to enter the kingdom of God. And so are we envious or jealous because some do not come around until the last moment, perhaps even on their deathbed? How many reprobate sinners have been on their deathbed and finally someone says, you know, all this life you've been living a terrible life and God has given you a chance to come to him. Do you want to finally confess your sins and come to you? It's happened. It's happened when I've entered a deathbed as well. The confessions that we hear are amazing, but they're said in sorrow, and thus they convert at the last moment, and they get into the life of heaven. Am I jealous? Am I jealous because they lived a life that they wanted to, and they had all kinds of fun, even if it was evil fun, of course? No. We should rejoice. Rejoice that maybe, even at the last hour, they have finally seen the light. And I hope nobody waits till the last moment, but it happens. In the middle of this COVID shutdown here in New York, someone asked me a question. They said, they made a statement. They said, God should have never given free will to human beings, especially since God knew that they would make the wrong choice. And then looking at me, they said, why did God do it? Why did God give human beings free choice? And I answered, as I always do, aha, a question for the ages, a question that we all ask. Not pretending to know the mind of God at all, I responded, well, the best I could. I said, if Adam and Eve had never been given free will, first of all, you and I might never have been born. And if we were, sure, life might not be a struggle, but it might be very boring as well. As I see it, life is a test. And I know that's a very old-fashioned view, but it's still true. Life is a test. How we live our lives, we will be rewarded accordingly. God made us out of love, out of pure love, for his love. We are challenged in this life to respond in a way that God wants us to respond in love. To respond not only in love to God, but also to one another, as it was said in that opening verse. We are to love God and our neighbor. And if we did that, maybe life would look more like the paradise that God had intended for us to live in. Well, after I gave that kind of an answer, he walked away, shaking his head, unsatisfied, I assume, with my answer. But I think that God has a wider view. Of course he has. He's God. As it says, his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. God has a much wider view of life and death and eternity. God has a more perfect ability to see the things that we do not see. He can see the end game, while we may only see the 10-yard line. Listen to St. Paul, what he says in that second reading. He knows and he acknowledges that he doesn't always understand God's plan for him, but he trusts God and accepts God's plan. St. Paul tells us that he is willing to die for whatever Christ wants. He admits that he would rather die quickly because he knows he will be in Christ's presence then, but he believes also that if it is God's will that he should live some more so that he can bring others to Christ, he will continue to do that. He will continue to work in God's vineyard and to do it in a spirit of joy. Either way, Paul knows that he's blessed. And I think that's the challenge for all of us, to trust and to live God's will always. To say like Paul, my life is Christ. I read a story not too long ago, I forget who the author was, but it said, much of our worship and religious practice amounts to what they considered, the author considered, a hoax that we try to perpetuate on God. We say, in effect, to God, all right, we'll give you worship, and you just kind of mind your own business. Your place is in church. Stay out of our workplaces, our bedrooms, our schools, our voting places. You're the God of religion, not a God of economics and politics. And the author said, and God laughs at us. Laughs at us. If you want to worship me, God says, then you're going to have to learn to care for what I care about and who I care about. And the Bible never tires of telling us who God cares about. God cares about the widow, the orphan, the stranger, the poor, the oppressed, the downtrodden. And God says, if those people don't matter to us, then perhaps God really doesn't matter all that much to us either. Interesting thought. Interesting. My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. No matter when we enter the vineyard of the Lord, we should thank God that he gives us that opportunity to work in that vineyard, to work with him and for him. And let us not be jealous or envious of those who come to work in the last hour, the last moment, and also receive a crown of glory. Let us try, at least, to think like God, and to remember that he cares, yes, for all lives, but he has a special place in his heart and in his generosity and in his mercy for the widow, the orphan, the stranger, the poor, the oppressed, and the downtrodden, for those people.